Well, how exciting is it to be here? Yeah, you've guessed it. I'm in Paris and I've got my painter's smock on. This is the city of culture, the city for the artists, the mecca for artists. How they migrated all over the world to Paris over the last couple of hundred years. Let's dwell on this in this edition of Dom's Diary and head now to the biggest art gallery in the world. What amazing place. This is the famous museum of the Louvre in Paris. And yes, come round here a second. These are the wonderful pyramids that appeared here, I guess about 30 years ago. Very much the sort of feature of President Mitterrand's vision of Paris, which was to combine the traditional and the sort of regal traditional with the new avant-garde and the modern. And that was an extraordinary vision, but one that was quite at home here in Paris, which wasn't afraid of trying something new. The Eiffel Tower, which appeared in the 1870s, was an example of that. And in fact, there were loads of people at the time who were saying, this is, well, I suppose to use now King Charles's famous phrase, the carbuncle on the face of an old friend. That was said about something else. But they were thinking, do we really want this great ugly brutish modern industrial thing to adorn the Parisian landscape? And the answer to that was, it proved such a success that yes, and now imagine Paris without the Eiffel Tower. This is, here is got the Royal Associations and the palace was eventually earmarked, set aside for the Royal Arts Collection, which is why there are people queuing here today. What's fun about coming here right now, which is just before 6 o'clock on the first Friday of the month, is that this is a freebie. So they open it for anybody who wants to come along for free, and we thought we'd come down here and benefit from that. Now, we're filming this just before the coronation of King Charles III, who'll be crowned on Saturday in London. And I thought it'd be rather fun, with that in mind, to earmark some special paintings, special works of art to go and see here in the Louvre. And that includes the wonderful painting by David of Napoleon and his coronation. And we're going to go and see that. Not sure if we can film in there, but it's the famous image. And what actually happened in history is that Napoleon, when he was elevating himself to becoming emperor, he got the Pope along, I mean, who else, frankly, to crown him in Notre Dame here in Paris. And as the Pope was putting the great episcopal blessing on the new emperor and about to put the crown, the imperial, new imperial crown of France on Napoleon's head, the emperor himself grabbed the crown and put it on his head. And I think this painting depicts that. So looking forward to seeing that. We're going to earmark a couple of other things. My secret, by the way, and I don't suppose this is entirely just me, my secret is when you're coming to an enormous museum like this, just target it, otherwise you'll get museum foot and then it'll all go horribly wrong. So we're going to target a few things. It's all in the same part of the museum, and we're going to go and see a famous painting of Egalite, doing tremendous things of female empowerment and good stuff. So we're going to go and see that, Venus de Milo. So we're going to the, frankly, bleeding obvious, but why not? What a great place this is going to be. And I love the fact that we're in this queue now, along with everyone else, looking forward to their monthly freebie. Come with, this will be good. Well, we've made it through the queue, and quite pleased, in a rather selfish point of view, to note that the queue behind us really extended a very long way. So, but it's all incredibly efficiently done. I guess they're used to doing this freebie, first Friday of the month. Fantastic outcome, I would say, of a sort of, I don't know, possibly the more socialist approach of France. Anyway, here we are. Look at this. Even outside, excited as I was to think about viewing this painting, this glorious painting of the coronation of Napoleon, Emperor Napoleon Bonaparte, nothing prepares you for the scale. Look, I've just got the room there in it, and this is just the most humongous size painting. Just look at that. Now, there's a bit of glare on there, so I'm going to go in a little bit and see these real details of faces. This is the equivalent of a photograph at the time. And now this is the Empress kneeling down. We're going to come to Napoleon over here. Look, there's the Pope, I was saying. And Napoleon taking his own imperial crown and putting it on his own head. So this tells a fantastic story. And Napoleon gave huge amounts of detail as to what the artist needs to do. David had to follow precise instructions. And one of the things about this picture, if we look at all these incredible faces, and up here, I've just seen it somewhere. Yes, just kind of going into the glare. Would that be Napoleon's mother looking down on all this sort of thing? This was very much not only Napoleon's status as the new Emperor of France, but it's very much his status within his family. So all his cousins and brothers and sisters, and many of his brothers became kings of countries that he was conquering at the time of this. So what a fantastic story, what a fantastic painting, and a massive privilege to be seeing it in the flesh, because frankly, this sort of thing you normally only see at picture postcard level. And here I am standing 6'2", utterly dwarfed by it. Well, now, whilst I was doing that bit of commentary, Sue was off earwigging around this incredible hall full of people who are all gathering and gaining this wonderful amounts of information. So she's embellished my narrative with a little extra knowledge. I pointed out Napoleon's mother in the center of the middle of the painting there. And in fact, this was a complete fib. She wasn't there. She didn't get on with her daughter-in-law, the Empress Eugenie. No, it wasn't Eugenie, that was the Napoleon III, the Empress Josephine, as in not tonight, of course. She didn't get on with her, so the mother actually refused to go to the coronation. So there's a little propaganda going on here. More to add to that propaganda is the whole movement towards becoming an emperor, which of course was superior to a king, and they chopped the king's head off in the generation before. But Emperor Charlemagne was the first of the Holy Roman Emperors way back 1,000 years before, and so Napoleon was really elevating himself to that status. So the most powerful person in the world really would have been the Pope. So you get the Pope along to kind of endorse your new status. But is it the Pope who's the most powerful, or the person he bestows this power upon? And I think we all know what the answer to that is. And my final thought whilst here, filming this just before the coronation of Charles II of Great Britain, is that whatever's going on in this picture, I think it's got very little to do with whatever will be happening in Westminster Abbey. A very different king, a very different royal, and a very different coronation. Well, moving into another room now, we move from David to Delacroix. Will we ever get out of the D's here in the Louvre? This is La Liberté, a famous picture. And I guess what's happening here is it's depicting both the hopes and excitement and thrill of overthrowing a regime. In this case, I think it was 1830, King Charles X of France, who was like one of the line of rotten kings, and they kept slinging him out. That's the way the French did things. Perhaps they still do. Story for another occasion. Yeah, and here we see not only the power of the revolution and its forthright kind of going forward, moving the people forward, moving to hopefully a better future. But at the same time, we see the casualties and the real horror and the shock of these corpses lay underneath the passing of the people as they're forging their better future. And joined by Sue, what does this painting say to you?
This is just showing all the, like the caption says, it's showing the powerful event in all its ambiguity, like this amazing, powerful sense of freedom being given form of this sensual, powerful woman. She is freedom. And then all around her is these awful, poor, dying men. The horror of war.
It's an interesting enshrinement of the concept of liberty within a woman at a time when this was a very, very male-dominated world. I wonder what that's about.
I don't know, but have you noticed how often they have a male figure for these things, like the Statue of Liberty?
Yeah.
The Scales of Justice?
Well, I suppose the Statue of Liberty is that person there in a great big statue in New York.
Absolutely.
In fact, that was given by the people of France to the Americans when they'd hoofed the British out of things.
Yeah, absolutely. So anyway,
wonderful to be here looking at this.
If you ever get a chance to come to it, do come and see it. It's hard to express the power of this painting unless you're with it in person, so
we were saying outside, I was saying outside, that let's come away and let everyone else enjoy.
Yeah. Let's slip away in this direction.
In a sea of pardons, we move this way. So I was saying outside the idea of doing a kind of targeted approach to the Louvre, otherwise you could just sort of fall apart in the massiveness of it all. We've been in a couple of rooms now, very much the sort of 19th century romantic period, depicting these great historical events. What do you think?
I'm blown away by it. It's everywhere you look. I thought that we could come through and see what we wanted to see, and instantly I was taken by painting after painting after painting. We're still going to be very focused about what it is that we want to do, so we just won't have time to do anything else any justice. But it's extraordinary. I hadn't appreciated the size of some of these paintings. And they're just showing French history and also like things like Agamemnon, like showing things from, you know, creations as well.
Yeah, and the very allegorical or biblical references.
Yeah. Lots of life stories. I think I'm looking at a painting of Joan of Arc over there. I think that must be Joan of Arc. I don't know, but
Joan of Arc, we can just walk towards that. Joan of Arc was obviously a medieval leader, famous story, visions from God about how to beat the English. But really, it was the 20th century where she became a saint and then this huge cultural figure for France. And I think what that was about, is just checking, that is Joan of Arc, is it?
Yes, Jeanne d'Arc.
Before I get carried away. It was really the ghastliness of the trenches of the First World War, and the French soldiers needed some hope, and they would hope they saw the ghost of Joan looking over them and looking after them. And that's why she was beatified or made a saint in the 1920s. And here she is looking everything of a person of God, but in her armor. And that probably is the central part of her story. Well, just coming away from Joan of Arc, I just noticed this one on the right here. This is such a famous episode in English history. And accordingly, I think that's probably why all the crowds are in other parts of the room. These are the two famous princes of the Tower of London. And this is another Delacroix. I haven't quite worked out the full symbolism, not quite sure what the dog's about, but look up here. These two boys, I think they were something like 10 and 12 at the time. On the left there, the Duke of York, Richard Duke of York, and on the right, King Edward V, who only reigned for a few months and never really in public view. History has decided that they were done away with by their ambitious uncle, Richard III, of course, but others say that it wasn't Richard III at all, it was the victor of Bosworth, Henry VII. Either way, these poor young boys came to an end, a sticky end, very early on in their lives. In perilous times, they were the victims. And if you look at their faces, perhaps Delacroix is hinting there at their concerns. They knew by now that they were in a very, very dangerous situation. And I guess they're reading the Bible, perhaps, as some comfort to their predicaments. And if this was a photograph, this would be the last photograph taken of them. And that, I'm imagining, is the bed that they were murdered in. Extraordinary scene from British history. Right, we're just coming to this room here. And there's a reason why everybody is coming in here. So a bit of a clue. You can see the airport style snaking for the queue. And over there, and I thought, well, the only way to find out where the Mona Lisa is to see the most intense crowd. And there is that intense crowd. I'm not overly inclined to get much closer to it than that. But putting it in its kind of setting, I guess, well, there's no I guess about that. The Mona Lisa is the most famous painting in the world. And that is why everybody's here, taking their little bit of it away with them for their holiday memories, on their memories of the Louvre. I thought it'd be quite interesting to see what else is in this room. And in fact, over here is one mightily impressive painting. It's so big, I'm not even sure I'm going to get it into the whole of my iPhone lens. This is a depiction of the wedding feast of Cana. And there he is in the middle, Christ. Story, of course, where they ran out of wine, so he converted the water into wine. It turned out the wine was rather better quality than the one that the hosts have been serving beforehand. And people were saying, why are you serving the best wine last? Because the convention would normally be serve the best wine first. But that was what Christ got up to. He likes a good party, apparently. Look, everyone's having a good time here. I love this detail over here. And in fact, although this is from the biblical reference, the time of Jesus, this is a 16th century Venetian knees up at a time when Venice really kind of was the center of the civilized universe. So perhaps the most interesting thing in here is not the Mona Lisa. It's this great thing here. Maybe there's a series to be made about famous paintings opposite, or rather, the paintings that coexist in the presence of famous paintings and they're opposite them. Just like I think there's a documentary to be made, in fact I bet it's been done, famous number twos in history. Always think about who gets to number one, but who got to number two, and often it's more interesting than who got to number one. Maybe this is number two to the Mona Lisa's number one. Right, let's get away from these crowds. Well, I've come away from the crowds, and there they are, still making their way into Mona Lisa territory. But Sue, you persevered, and you got to the front of that thick queue that I was just filming. How was it?
Oh, it's beautiful. It's beautiful. It's the first word out of my mouth. But when I was getting up to it, I was just like, oh my goodness, I'm standing in front of the Mona Lisa. It's incredible. What a moment.
Can you answer that question as to why it is the most famous painting in the world?
I don't know. There's something deeply, inviting. It's very inviting, the way that it's been painted. It's warm, it's soft, it's got texture, but it's not lumpy. It feels, the whole thing looks as if you could reach out and touch her. It really does. There's such warmth in her skin and on her smile. And the landscape is intriguing, because you can't see it very clearly.
So it kind of draws you into a world that separates from where you are now, 2023,
in the Louvre. You honestly feel like you could step in and sit beside her, and you would want to.
Yeah.
Because she's not, I was looking at it thinking, she's so beautiful, and then I thought, is she actually beautiful, or is it the painting that's beautiful? And then I thought, no, she's one of those interesting faced people. She's got this gentle smile that looks like she's, she was the, her name was Lisa Geraldini. She's the wife of a silk merchant, and she met Leonardo when he was visiting that part of Italy, Florence I think it was, and he painted her, and he never finished that painting. So as you come to the front of the painting, you can see that the landscape's not finished, it's just sketched. I wouldn't have known that unless I'd actually read about it just now, because you're just so entranced with this woman, with the background. It's really lovely.
Well, I'm glad you went to see it, and I've seen it many years ago. But I think I've now developed museum foot. I don't know how your feet are, but to my mind, we're in Paris. I think it's time for a little glass of something and a wander up the Champs-Élysées. What do you think?
Well, this short wonder, so we can sit down and have a glass of something while we appreciate the beauty of where we are. But yes.